On a smaller scale, a St. Paddy's Day leprechaun.
The leprechaun starts out with an aluminum foil base. This not only saves clay, but it makes the clay stronger by promoting better heat distribution during baking. Form balls for the head and torso until you have something shaped like this. The leprechaun is made of oven-baked polymer clay. Karen likes to blend some translucent clay into the flesh color to give it a more natural look. Work the flesh clay over the top of the aluminum foil to form the head and neck, applying the clay in a fairly thick layer to cover about the top half of the armature. As you can see from the sculpture that Karen used for inspiration, the eye sockets are indented. She used a blunt tool to make eye sockets for the leprechaun. The eyes are made from black seed beads. Use a sharp object like a toothpick to help press them into place. Then take a blob of flesh-colored clay and work it into the ridge between the eye sockets to form a nose shape. Karen chose a fairly bulbous nose, but any nose shape will work. Add blobs to the side of the nose to form nostrils. This leprechaun's nose is nice and broad, so the nostrils are big, but you can make smaller ones. Another blob gets formed into the lower lip. You can use a toothpick or X-Acto knife to work the mouth shape. More blobs get worked into the side of the face to make the leprechaun's cheeks. A small piece of rose-colored clay gets worked into the mouth for the tongue. At this point, it looks like the leprechaun is sticking his tongue out at you, but that will change. Teeth are cut out of a flattened piece of white clay and worked into the mouth. And now yet another blob of clay to form a chin. You'll notice that Karen keeps adding details a little at a time as she goes. Facial hair is added as small strips of orange-brown clay pressed onto the face and then textured with an X-Acto knife. A little hair above the ears is another nice detail. By the way, Karen added the ears between takes. This leprechaun is bald on top, so his hair is just a rectangle on the back of his head, again textured with the X-Acto knife. Now to the hands. Karen forms a flattened rectangle on the end of a log shape. She cuts away the wedge on the side that leaves the thumb. Then she cuts three slits to form the fingers. Fingernails are formed with a flat-edged wooden tool. She makes the crease at the base of the fingers by gently scoring with the X-Acto knife. Then she shapes the individual fingers to pose the hand and cuts the wrist to the proper length. Now time to make shoes. Karen decided that she wanted the soles on these shoes to be a different color, so she formed them separately and then sculpted the shoes onto the top. These being leprechaun shoes, she added a gold buckle. The leprechaun is wearing yellow socks, so the legs are formed from yellow clay with toothpicks to keep them straight and help them stay in the pants cuffs. Another detail that Karen added was a tongue for each shoe. The body is worked over the bottom of the aluminum armature up to the neck. Leave enough padding on the bottom for the leprechaun to have, well, a bottom, as well as sockets for the legs. The legs are made from rolls of pants-colored clay attached to the leg sockets. Karen used the knife to score a knee joint and then played around with the leg positions until she was satisfied with the pose. She used an X-Acto knife and a rounded wooden tool to make a hole for the feet and also to form a pants cuff. She then inserted the legs into the pants cuffs. This leprechaun is wearing a yellow sweater under his green coat, so Karen formed the sweater front and collar from yellow clay. She made the jacket from a square of clay with a little neck piece cut out. This she draped around the leprechaun, not smoothing or pressing it too close to the body, so that she could form fabric folds. Details add a lot of personality to your sculpture. Karen cut a vent at the back of the jacket and added a strap with gold buttons and gold buttons on the front. A strip of brown between the sweater and the pants forms a belt, with a gold buckle added, of course. Making the arms is similar to making the legs. Karen wrapped yellow cuffs around the wrists before inserting the hands into the sleeves. The crown of a hat is made over a small ball of foil, and the brim formed from a ring of clay around the bottom. Karen played with several styles of hats before settling on this one. She finished it off with a brown band and a gold buckle. Put it all together, and here is a mischievous leprechaun for St. Paddy's.
It's not as hard as it looks. I made this one all by myself.
It's not hard. Watch me finish my leprechaun.